Human resources, human capital, people, and culture. This single vocation has many names. HR professionals are responsible for what is arguably the most critical success factor within any organization, its talent. HR Studio Podcast brings you bi-weekly interviews with HR executives, thought leaders, authors, speakers, and trend spotters from the world of HR and beyond. Listen, learn, and leverage. Welcome to HR Studio Podcast, building the next generation of HR leaders. HR Studio is brought to you by AJ O'Connor Associates, a trusted human capital consulting partner to emerging, mid-market, and world-class organizations. For over 35 years, AJO has built its reputation on experienced listening, exceptional quality, and caring partnerships, delivering services in 30 states and 20 countries. To learn more, visit us at ajoconnor.com and be sure to check out our top-ranked HR blog and sign up to receive email alerts while you're there.
Welcome, everyone. I'm your host on today's HR Studio podcast. My name is Fred Bunsa. I'm excited today to be joined by Todd Henry. Todd teaches leaders and organizations how to establish practices that lead to everyday brilliance. He's the founder of Accidental Creative, a company that helps creative people and teams be prolific, brilliant, and healthy. Some great adjectives. He regularly speaks and consults with companies about how to develop practices that lead to everyday brilliance. He's written 4 books. He speaks internationally on productivity, creativity, leadership, and passion for work, and he builds tools for those as well. His latest book, which I have a copy of right here, is called Herding Tigers: Leading Talented, Creative People Requires a Different Skill Set than What Most Management Books Offer. And in Herding Tigers, Todd provides some new blueprints to help us become better leaders that our teams need. So, welcome to the podcast, Todd. It's great to have you here.
Thanks, Fred. It's great to be here.
My first question is a little bit from left field is, how many people introduce you as Henry instead of Todd? I thought that's probably a regular occurrence for you, right?
It unfortunately is, especially when I'm traveling. I get a lot of Mr. Henry Todds, or people call me Henry, you know, or Mr. Todd, thinking they're being polite. Actually, there was a meme going around on Facebook a couple of days ago. A friend said, you know, my friend Mitch Joel said, I'm Mitch, not Joel. And he said, keep it going. And I said, I'm Todd, not Henry, because I get that so often. But yes. It is unfortunate.
Good. Well, Fred would like to ask you a question. I noticed in the book you talk a lot about managing creatives and how to get the most from them. And so my first question is who are these creatives? Am I in that category, hopefully, or is it someone else you have in mind?
You are in that category. Yeah. Really, you know, when we talk about creativity, I think sometimes we conflate two things. We conflate creativity with art. You know, people think, well, I'm not creative because I'm not one of those designers, or I'm not one of those writers, or I'm not one of those people who are making art, you know, as a function of my job. The reality is, if you have to solve problems on a daily basis, then you're required to be creative. Creativity is problem solving. It's connecting dots. It's synthesizing patterns. And so, yes, a designer is certainly creative when they have to create a design to solve a problem for a client and whatnot. But, you know, an HR director is certainly creative when they have to develop a new system, develop a new training, figure out, you know, how to solve some very complex organizational issue that's going on. You know, that's certainly a very creative act. And so the answer really is, any of us who have to solve problems every day, we could tag ourselves as creative, even if it's not art, right? We definitely are creative, which means we're also prone to many of the same dynamics and problems and issues and pitfalls that some of those traditional quote unquote creatives are prone to.
Okay. So it sounds like it covers all of us who are working in offices, trying to bring new ideas and new thinking and create value in our everyday work.
I believe that's true. You know, the phrase, the accidental creative, which was the title of my first book, was actually coined when I was talking to somebody from a large consumer packaged goods company, and they were, you know, sharing how they didn't think they were creative. I said, well, you are creative. You're just an accidental creative. You didn't intend to be, but you are, because, you know, as a function of your job, you have to go to work, you have to figure it out, you have to solve problems, you have to create value out of nothing. You have to make it up as you go. Mm-hmm. You're often inventing the mechanism by which you will deliver the value as you're trying to deliver the value. I mean, all of these things are traits of what it means to be a part of the create on demand world that we all exist in today.
Excellent. So what inspired you to write this book? You've got a couple others there. What did you see as the need out there that this book helps fill?
So my first book was The Accidental Creative, and it was written out of, you know, sort of painful experience as a create on demand professional and some of the trials and tribulations and pitfalls we can fall into when we're trying to create on demand. And then I followed that up with a few other books targeted at individuals in the marketplace. But as I was out working with companies and doing consulting and talking to thousands of creative pros out in the marketplace, one of the consistent themes that I heard was, this is all great, but my manager won't this, or my manager won't that. And I said, hold on, time out. You know, first of all, you have to take ownership of your creative process. This is not your manager's problem. This is your problem. But I also realized that there really wasn't a book targeting or helping managers who have to deal with this nebulous creative process to understand what it is that highly talented creative people need from them in order to provide value for their clients, for their organizations. There are a lot of great general management books, and they're all phenomenal. But I hadn't encountered one that I could recommend for people that really help people understand the unique dynamics of the creative process and some of the nuances that are involved when you're leading a creative process. And so because I couldn't find the book, as often happens, I decided it was probably something that I needed to address. So in many ways, this is the sequel to my first book, which came out in 2011. This is sort of the managerial companion to that first book.
I see. So The Accidental Creative is for the the individual who's in roles that need to be creative. And this Herding Tigers is the one that says, if I've got responsibility for managing people who have those responsibilities, this is the book that will give me the best direction to help them be more creative.
That's correct.
Okay.
Yes, that's correct.
And I saw a link on your site with literally someone trying to herd some cats, and not tigers, but cats. I saw one person being mauled by a tiger. I don't know if that was your personal experience, but that's the idea here. Is that this isn't a logical, straightforward, very easy process. I take it.
Yeah, that's correct. Yeah, I don't know if you've heard this phrase, but I've been living with it for most of my professional life, that leading creative people is like herding cats, you know, and the implication there is, you know, creative people are flighty, that they are easily distractible, that it's difficult to discipline them and keep them targeted on something. And that's, first of all, I haven't found that to be true. You know, most of the creative professionals that I know are just that. They're professionals, they're highly driven, they're focused. But also, you know, I sort of found the implication a little bit demeaning as a creative pro myself. Yeah. You know, I really, the phrase herding tigers came out of a talk I was giving at an event, and there were, I don't know, 400 or 500 people at the event. And I said, you know, how many of you have heard this phrase that leading creative people is like herding cats? And all the hands went up. Right. I said, it's not, it's more like herding tigers. These are powerful, majestic creatures capable of incredible feats one moment and then turning and ripping you to shreds the next if they're not led appropriately. Right. So we have to individually, strategically lead creative people, which means we have to know them. We have to understand what makes them tick. We have to let them know we see you, we understand you, and we want to create an environment in which you uniquely can thrive. And that's really what it's about. It's not really about herding. It's about individually leading and strategically helping creative people have what it is they need in order to provide their best work to the organization and to our clients.
Okay. So you make a really interesting observation in the book that there's two factors I picked up on, two factors that you say are incredibly important for this thriving to happen. And one is stability and the other is challenge. And I'm wondering if you could, for our audience, if you could just talk a little bit about the dynamic between how those two forces interact.
Yeah. So stability really is about providing a playing field on which creative people know that there are clear boundaries, there are clear rails, there's a clear philosophy guiding the process. The process itself is somewhat transparent so that they're not guessing about motives, they're not guessing about mechanisms. The means by which the work is being done is pretty transparent, pretty clear, as are the boundaries. You know, there's this myth, Fred, that creative people want complete freedom, total freedom, just don't fence me in, let me do my own thing. Yeah. And it's really not true. If you really dive into deep conversation with creative people, a lot of times that sentiment is expressed because they're pushing back against overly constrictive boundaries, right? They're pushing back against controlling behavior from their manager. But what they really crave, what they really want are clear but expansive boundaries within which to do their work.
Clear so they and need expansive, you say.
Right. Yes, yes. So they want to know that you're going to protect them. They want to know that you're going to protect them from the organization, from the demands that often filter down and become, you know, sort of the chaos monster that sucks the life out of them as they're trying to go about their work. So they want to know that you're going to protect them, but they also want clarity from you, clarity of objectives, clarity of process, and transparency as part of that. So stability is really critical. The foundation of stability is trust. If they don't trust you as a leader, which sounds really obvious, but the ways in which we lose trust are not always so obvious. You know, there are small ways that we can lose trust and not even be aware of it. So we have to provide stability. But the second thing that creative people need is challenge.
Okay, so stability they want to be first and then challenge mm-hmm. second. Tell us how that factors
yes.
in.
They creative people want to be pushed. They want to be engaged in work that matters to them and that challenges them personally and professionally. They want to be attached to ideas that they love, ideas that feel a little bit uncomfortable and maybe even dangerous to them. So they want to be pushed beyond what they think is capable, what they're capable of accomplishing in order to feel engaged with the work. And so part of that is they want freedom. They want permission to take risks, to try new things. Many creative people will wait for you to give them permission to take risks. They want to know that they have the organizational stamp of approval to venture out into dangerous territory. And they need to be told that. Many creative people need to be told that, despite the myth that creative people are freewheeling, you know, danger loving, walking on the edge, you know, wearing leather jackets kind of people. No, I mean, really, they want to but the leather jacket thing was kind of weird. what they really want from you is permission to try new things, to experiment, to take risks, to stretch their bounds. But within that, they also want to be seen. They want to be known. They want you to know them uniquely, to understand what makes them tick, and they want to be coached by you to help them be better than they thought they could be. Now, here's the real challenge with all of this stability challenge discussion is stability and challenge, as you can imagine, exist in tension with one another. Yeah. So as you increase stability, you might think, hey, I'm going to hyper formalize processes. I'm going to make everything transparent. Everything's going to be predictable to the organization. We're going to know exactly what it is we're doing, and the work is going to be predictable. And that's great. But as you do that, you decrease the amount of challenge, the perceived challenge that creative people on your team feel, right? So it's really easy for them to begin to feel stuck or lost or not feel pushed to that place where they feel alive, they feel like they're thriving. And as you ramp up challenge in the organization, you tend to destabilize things. As you're pushing people to try new things, to take risks, to push the bounds, then you tend to destabilize the organization. And some people can live in that space, which is why you have to know individuals. Many people are very comfortable in that place. Some people, not so much so. They need more stability. You know, there are many organizations that I encounter, and I'm sure that you do too, Fred, in the course of your work, and I'm sure many of the listeners have experienced this, maybe even your organization, where you're trying to take on a lot of work and it's very challenging and we're not really sure how we're going to get it all done and process isn't really all that clear. So we're doing maybe more than we should be doing given the stability that we're experiencing organizationally. And the team begins to grow angry. They begin to feel used and abused and overburdened. And you're not going to retain highly talented creative people for long if that's the case. These teams grow angry. I call them shooting star organizations because they produce a tremendous amount of work for a short period of time. And then they burn out. They burn out and they're not capable of sustaining the work because there aren't processes undergirding that to support the ambitious creative work they're trying to do. And at the same time, there are organizations that are overly controlling, absolutely, overly predictable, mm-hmm, overly processized. That's not a word, but I'm going to make it a word right now, to the point that the creative people on the team begin to feel bored and stuck. They don't feel challenged. They're not doing work that really engages them. And as I encounter teams out in the marketplace, some teams say, well, there are certain clients that make us feel just overwhelmingly bored because they won't let us push ourselves. They won't let us, you know, challenge ourselves and stretch ourselves. And so as a manager, as a leader, you need to keep your finger on the pulse and make sure that the individuals on your team have the stability and the challenge that they need individually. And again, different people can live in different places and you need to diagnose that and understand wow, this person seems to be bored. They seem to be stuck. As I'm having my one-on-ones with them, they're reporting to me that the work isn't really challenging them right now. Maybe I need to find some part of their portfolio of work that can challenge them, that can push them in some way, even if it's ancillary to their core responsibilities. Okay. I'm going to attach them to a project over here, let them do some cross-functional exploration, mm-hmm. and at least give them something to keep them engaged and challenged while they're doing the very important but not challenging work that's necessary for the health of the organization.
So they can help shape their role or their responsibilities, whether they need more stability or more challenge, they might be able to incorporate that into some of their day-to-day responsibilities.
Correct. Yes. Or even frankly, outside of their day-to-day responsibilities, if, you know, it could be an some sort of Skunk Works project that you develop for the organization to give them a place to play or to experiment or to try new things. It can be anything of that nature, but they need something to keep them engaged. You won't retain talented people for very long if they don't feel challenged, if they don't feel like this is a place where I can stretch myself and try new things. Now, there are a lot of mediocre people who might be happy to camp out in that space for a long time, but you don't want the mediocre people, right? You want the super talented people.
So given that our audience is, we have a lot of rising HR leaders who subscribe to our podcast, they're often the ones who are the most attuned to what the culture of the organization is, whether it's overly stabilized or there's not a lot of stability or structure at all, and it's just really freewheeling. Do you have any suggestions, or is there a particular part of your book you can direct them to where they could help better balance this creative tension between stability and challenge and push the organization in either direction based on what they see as needed?
Yeah, I think really what is necessary is for you to stay in touch with the sort of the frontline leaders, the people who are on the front line managing the team, and stay in constant conversation with them about what they're experiencing, what is being reported back from the people who are actually doing the work. Because often, you know, if you are in an HR function and you have a touch point with several different managers throughout the organization, those managers aren't talking to one another. You know, they're not interacting necessarily about, they're interacting about the work, but they're not interacting about how the work is being done, right? We love to talk about the work and the projects and the problems and the clients. We don't often talk about those little conversations that we're having with people about how they're feeling and how they're interacting. So simply having that conversation on a regular basis, hey, how many of you are noticing right now that your people on your team are feeling bored, right? Or are they feeling overly challenged right now? Are people rushing? I mean, there are a number of questions that I offer in the book in the checkpoint section at the end of each chapter. Things like, are you noticing people rushing in breathless to meetings, you know, 3 minutes late? Are you noticing minor missed deadlines within the organization? Are you noticing, you know, all of these things are small but potentially significant signs that people aren't getting what they need right now from leadership. And so most of us aren't blowing it in the big ways, Fred, right? Like most of us aren't overtly lying to our team, intentionally running our team into the ground, intentionally working our team 85 hours a week. Like we're not doing that. It's the little things that signify health or a lack of health. And that's really where the HR director is really uniquely positioned because, you know, she or he can put their ear to the ground and really listen for the patterns in the culture. And so I think it has to be an active, ongoing conversation. And by the way, this can change in a matter of a handful of weeks, right? Everything can be going great, and then a couple of projects come on board, and suddenly the entire vibe of the organization changes.
Yes.
Yeah. And so it's not a set it and forget it thing. It's a constant, you have to be tweaking the dials of stability and challenge constantly if you want to make sure that you're keeping your people engaged. And frankly, this is also about getting the best work out of the people on the team. I mean, let's not sort of turn our back on the obvious here, which is you've hired talented people, hopefully. You've put them in the right roles. You don't want to leave work on the table, you know? And that's really what's happening if people begin to check out because they're not getting what they need from you.
It seems to me, I heard somebody say one time that you need to always distinguish between something that's a problem to be solved or a tension to be managed. It's not so you're not solving for the perfect balance of stability and challenges. What you're doing is you're managing it based on where the organization is, where the culture is, and what the workload is. Is that right?
That's exactly right. That okay. It is a attention and really creativity is attention, right? The creative process is attention. Managing the creative process. I mean, we live in the tension. There is no resolution of that because the moment we engage in any creative act, we are stepping straight into the midst of tension between what is and what could be. And you're dealing with ego, intuition, all of the soft side of our work. You know, if you're just cranking out widgets and you're just, you know, like engaging in some sort of predictable process, it's very easy because at the end of the day, you measure, there are metrics there. You can say, how many widgets did we make? Great. How much money did we spend? Great. But when you're doing highly qualitative work, which most of us are doing, it's really difficult to measure. And so there's always going to be tension there between what is, what should be, and what actually was at the end of the process. That's always the tension you're going to live in.
All right. Well, I think a final question for me is there anything in the book or in your research, Todd, that went into creating the book that was either the most counterintuitive or the most surprising to you that you just took you back or you weren't expecting?
Yeah, there's a whole chapter about leading the idea generation process for managers. And I was very surprised that many managers reported to me that they don't engage in a typical brainstorming session when they lead a creative process. That instead they break up their team and they do a multi-stage idea process. And the main reason was, and this is reported to me by a handful of leaders, and one of them termed it because of fast twitch and slow twitch people. Right. They said that there are many people, and I know I had the same reaction, like, what? Huh?
What?
when many people, and you've probably been a part of these brainstorming sessions, you go into the brainstorm and you have, let's say, 10 people in the room. And the moment you start generating ideas, about four of those people are just popcorning ideas like there's no tomorrow. And by the end of about 10 or 15 minutes, each of them has 30 ideas on the board. Meanwhile, there are four people sitting in the corner, completely silent, maybe raising their hand every so often, but then they sort of put it back down the moment that somebody, you know, a little louder and more boisterous, you know, begins to speak. The problem is that the people who monopolize the attention in the brainstorming session are what we call fast twitch people. These are people who are wired to generate ideas on the spot, and they'll generate 100 ideas and maybe one of them is valuable. And then you have slow twitch people who 2 days later will come to your office and knock on the door, and they'll walk in with one idea that is the absolute most stellar idea that you've ever heard, right? But it took them a couple of days to process, to think about it. It's not an introversion extroversion thing. It's the way that their individual creative process works. And so what many people have told me is they will assign work ahead of time. When they come into the meeting, the homework is you bring a couple of your best ideas. So the fast twitch people that have 100 ideas, they get it down to the two that they think are best. The slow twitch people might only have two or three ideas, but they bring those two or three ideas. And then you go around and discuss the ideas that you bring to the meeting instead of relying on the energy of that brainstorming session. That was an interesting observation. And what was interesting to me is that in all of my work with companies, I don't often get to go inside of that process. So to hear several people reporting that they've been engaging in that same kind of experiment was really counterintuitive and exciting to me, especially as a slow twitch person, because I am a slow twitch person and have found myself frustrated in those meetings from time to time.
There's a clear acknowledgement of your own style right there. That's great. I think I'm more on the fast twitch. I can't shut it off sometimes. They just keep coming, and most of them are not good, but they just keep coming anyway. So,
well, the interesting thing about it is too, I've spent so much time leading brainstorming sessions for companies, right? Like helping them generate ideas, and so it's funny to admit as a session facilitator that I tend to be more slow twitch than fast twitch.
Yeah. Well, then, so what you're saying is it's all about your preparation heading into those sessions that gets the best output.
That's exactly right.
So know your twitch style, as it were. I don't think I've ever said that before. And prepare and plan accordingly, like anything else. That's
exactly.
Great. Todd, any final thoughts before we close out the podcast here? Any final thoughts that you want to either emphasize or that hasn't come up that you think our audience would find helpful and valuable?
Yeah, I think the main thing, and especially when you're in an HR function in an organization, you have so much influence over the culture, right? And how the culture is defined. And you know, I think we often get lost in the thought that our legacy is the work that we do. You know, our legacy is whatever product we produce or whatever service we provide or how satisfied our clients are. And that's fine. That's all very important. But frankly, the reality is in 50 years, most people aren't going to remember your company, right? In 100 years, very few, if any, companies are going to be remembered, right? In 100 years. But what will continue to resonate is your personal impact on the people that you influence and you lead. And so if you begin to consider that I have a unique opportunity through my role in HR, where I have my fingers are in the lives of a lot of aspects of the organization here, and I have the opportunity to influence in a deep way, you know, my encouragement would be just make sure that you understand that your legacy is being built through every interaction, every conversation, and that legacy will continue to echo through generations of people who follow. And in 10 years, when somebody's asked, hey, can you name a person who had a significant influence on your life? You know, my hope is that that would be you. So I want you to be a leader who makes echoes.
That's awesome. Echoes. So there it is, everyone. Your advice for the day is begin with the end in mind, as Covey would say, and
yes,
as Todd Henry would say, be a leader who makes echoes. So Todd, thank you so much for joining us today. This was really a wonderful conversation. For those of you who'd like to learn more about how to follow Todd and access some of the resources that he's mentioned here, including a link to his new book, Herding Tigers, simply visit HRStudioPodcast.com. We'll have all the information there, as well as the show notes from today's episode and prior episodes. Todd, thank you very much for the time today. We really appreciate it.
Thank you, Fred. It's been a great conversation.
Take care.
Thank you for listening to HR Studio Podcast, building the next generation of HR leaders. To discover additional information from this week's episode and to catch up on all episodes, visit HRStudioPodcast.com. Subscribe to the HR Studio Podcast list while there and receive alerts and future updates.